What would the neighbors, what would they say?
Well, they used to call us, they'd call us niggers. And then they'd say, there goes that black man with the white woman.
Tell me about at night when you hear everyone.
At night, after we got finished doing our chores, we would get ready to go get in our feather beds. And someone would always be around the house and they would be saying, Tootsie, Al. And I would want to go look out the window. And my grandmother would say, no, don't look out the window. And don't make any noise. Just be quiet. And they would still be outside calling. Every night. There wasn't a night that passed. Not one night.
I don't believe they were both killed by the same people.
Who found the body in the morning?
My father and I had found it, and then Dick Johnson came down afterwards going to wherever he was going.
You stated that a wallet was found about, 25 feet or farther from the body, would you say?
Oh, probably 15, 20 feet, yeah.
But
the only thing, though, money-wise, was a penny that was in his pocket.
Yeah, well, they say that Harris, the Douglas Harris, he was a big person. I can't imagine how he fit in that little hole. How I measured it was 19 inches by 20 inches, and I know I couldn't get one leg in there if I had to.
Not unless they greased you.
Now, he accused you of this thing, you know, of the two murders you said?
Right.
That he said were murders. How did that come out? Did that go in the court, or he just said?
That was just a chuckle. I paid a lawyer to represent me. My lawyer and the prosecutor got together and decided it was no case.
I gotcha.
What I do, what I can. But I'm not a fool, there's no need to pretend. Just because you got yourself in some shit, it doesn't mean I have to come deal with it.
At that time, Norwich was a bitch. It was a bitch at that particular time.
I think we have as good enough name as anybody else in this town. We're not angels, but yet we're not devils either. I mean, there's dirt underneath everybody's rug, if you get to digging.
Everybody that I knew that knew Mr. Ruley was always favorable about him. I mean, some of them maybe didn't appreciate his art, but they never had anything personal against him.
It may be appropriate to see Ellis Ruley as an outsider, particularly given the fact that he lived in such an unnurturing environment.
Most artists never know fame. They work in obscurity, often enough in lifelong obscurity. Now on the art and the fate of Ellis Ruley.
A construction worker by day and a painter at night, Ellis Ruley never sought attention.
He kept himself. Wasn't loud, boisterous, he just quiet.
Ellis Ruley's nephew, John Ruley.
Whatever was on him being a quiet man, he just put it on canvas.
The secret of this gentleman's paintings might never have gained a wider audience except for the detective work of Glenn Robert Smith, a folk art collector who bought one of Ruley's works at a flea market and then spent 3 years trying to find out more about the artist and his life. In the process, he uncovered a tale of intrigue and possibly murder.
What drew me to the art, I suspect it was the stark whiteness of the characters, almost a ghostly-like quality.
The painting that caught Glenn Smith's eye was Ruley's Adam and Eve. It is now the cover of a new book Smith has written on the painter's life. Ellis Ruley bought his home in a previously all-white neighborhood of Norwich in 1933 with money he received in an insurance settlement after a car accident.
Dad, remember over there? My grandfather had pride in those dogwood trees.
But the Ruley family could not ignore the world around them. In 1948, Ellis Ruley's son-in-law was found mysteriously drowned in the family well. As violence closed in, Ruley continued to paint, often depicting animals cornered and confronting danger. 11 years after his son-in-law's death, on January 18, 1959, Ellis Ruley was himself found dead, his body frozen and bloody. His death was ruled accidental by local authorities, a finding the family rejects to this day.
I would say, truthfully, that he was murdered.
all that adulation I was having because of finding this painting in Ellis Ruley, after it settled down, I had the realization that this was not about me, it was not about my experiences, it was about Ellis Ruley, this unknown artist that would have been lost to history had it not been finding that painting. And then, from that moment on, I then dedicated my life to tell the Ellis Ruley story.
To begin to understand the history of the production of art by African Americans in the 20th century, that they go and get Robert Ferris Thompson's book called Flash of the Spirit.
What I think about Ellis Ruley, it's hard to compact it because he's a very important guy. Why I think he's an artist, not with any adjective, an artist like Degas, like Rouault, an artist, period. So we get him out of all these ghettos and into where he is, if people would just see it in the mainstream of Western art.
One may find darkness at the edge of what otherwise seems to be great pleasantness. This is a man who's living in an unnurturing and unfriendly environment. So the work, though it has a pleasantness to it, a seeming easiness, turns out to have another side, an edgy side, a darkness.
His paintings were selling for $15 each. And I went to New York and took some of his work, I would say about five or six of his paintings, with me and showed them to my dealer, also several dealers on 57th Street. And no one at that time seemed to be interested in his work, and they were not willing to handle his work.
I think Ellis Ruley's work moves on about three or four different levels at once. That on one hand, there's a simplistic one of just the paintings themselves. I think in another way, if you see art as a form of travel, of inner and outer travel, he was traveling through the society of the U.S. at the time that he was making these paintings. So he was testing a lot of corners, and he was testing a lot of edges in the sense of where he stood in relationship to the overall society.
When you're black, they have to define you in soul or pop or something. They have to make different categories. They never let us compete on an open and fair playing field. So by separating those, by this, it's a form of control. That's the history of this country. That's just another way of control.
So I met her at her house, very nice house, and she said she'd give me $25,000, and what would I do with it? I said, I'd like to exhume those bodies and to prove once and for all, was this murder or was it not murder? And so Dr. Michael Bodden, the famed forensic pathologist, had talked at the O.J. Simpson trial, and I went on line and I found his number and I called him at his house and he answered, and I, very protective and not wanting to talk to me, but I used my gift of the gab that I was getting very good at getting my foot in doors, and within an hour and a half he committed to it. He would do it.
Yeah, I was contacted to look into what happened to Ellis Ruley and his son-in-law Douglas Harris. Family thought that both were murdered, and they wanted to see if they could bring some conclusions to their 60-year concern.
I understand that the family had contacted five funeral homes in the Norwich area, and they agreed. But once they found out that it was regarding the mysterious death of Ellis Ruley and Douglas Harris, they declined. When the vault company brought the caskets up, the caskets looked like canoes that had been in the ocean and washed ashore. They were decomposed, the top had just kind of caved in, and I really didn't expect to see the caskets looking like they did.
Douglas Harris was found head down in a well, in an empty well, and he had multiple fractures to his skull bones, as listed on the coroner's report. And when we look at the fractures, we will be able to tell if they are due to an accidental fall or to being beaten up. Ellis Ruley was also diagnosed as having head injuries, and we'll try to evaluate what injuries are present, whether they are from accidentally falling on his roadway or whether there was some other reason for him to have injuries.
Live from WFSB, Connecticut's number one local news.
Now at 5:30, exhumed and examined from the grave. That's what's being done to the bodies of a late Norwich artist and his son-in-law after many speculate the men died from foul play back in the 1940s and 50s. Channel 3's Courtney Zeller joins us live with the mobile newsroom from Norwich now, as she was there as both men were reburied at Maplewood Cemetery. Courtney.
Now, this all started because one man from California bought this artist's painting and he just wanted to learn more about him and how he died. Now, after all these years, the family of this artist could get the answers they've been looking for. Being reburied and remembered. Norwich artist Ellis Ruley and his son-in-law Douglas Harris are lowered into their final resting place at Maplewood Cemetery.
Though the wheels of justice grind slowly, they do grind.
It has been decades of heartache for the family.
It's been hard.
Diane LaSalle is Ruley's great-granddaughter. She says it was Ruley who raised her at a young age. She wants answers about his death.
He showed me the way. I had to know. He took me out of a foster home where I was being abused. Him and Wilhelmina showed me what love was really all about.
When Ruley was 77 years old, he was found in a pool of blood at the end of his driveway on Hammond Avenue. The house caught fire 2 years after Ruley's death. Today, that area is heavily wooded. Harris died 11 years earlier after falling headfirst into a well in 1948. He was 38 years old. The deaths of both men have been a mystery to some. Many suspect it was because they were black. For Glenn Palmedo Smith, he wanted to know more about Ruley after buying a piece of his art. He later wrote books and is now involved in a documentary.
This has been gnawing at me for 25 years, and I've been trying to do exactly what we've done here, to exhume the bodies, let's get to the bottom of it, and have a real investigation.
Autopsies were performed on both men this weekend. If foul play is suspected, the cases will be reopened. We're live with the mobile newsroom tonight in Norwich. Courtney Zeller, Channel 3 Eyewitness News.
Take me across, wash all my troubles away, and I know the lucky old son now, he's got nothing to do but roll around heaven all day. He got nothing but roll around heaven all day. I say he just a roll around heaven all day. Now you say it.
Wish right now to find out the truth about both deaths and to clear his name from being just someone who they found in the road drunk.
That's right.
Which is very, very hard to believe.
That's right.
And that justice be served
right.
To our family.
That's right. Justice.
And that's it.